as you can see, I'm with ID Core. So my supervisors, well, there's David in the room from Edinburgh. And then I got supervisors from Exeter and Strathclyde as well. And my project is sponsored by Wave Energy Scotland. Well, believe it or not, this is my first AES seminar. So I decided to have some background on me as well, just in case like people don't know me exactly. Like, this is a good way to introduce me. And at the same time, because actually I'm in the last year of the project, I really wanted to stress, I'd like to see my project to be taken forward in the future as well, or parts of it. So I think the focus of this presentation is like to try to get some interest into some of the methods I'm using, and so that maybe you could use it in your research as well for different types of applications. So I'll try to make it really simple, really basic to understand, and rather than having lots of things from my project, just like to stress the points that can be taken and applied to any other types of energy systems. So starting with background on me, I'm from Italy, as you can tell from the accent. I'm from, you can see Milan and Florence here, Venice, but definitely Modena is better. I know it's not really well known outside of Italy, so maybe you will have heard of the balsamic vinegar or the Ferrari. And yeah, before moving on, as you can see, Modena is actually quite far. It's about 100 kilometers from the nearest sea. And I really wanted to study naval architecture, so that's why I decided to go to Southampton, because I would have had to go to a different city anyway. So I did my education in English. But I also spent a semester in Germany at the Technical University of Hamburg, and then went back to Southampton to finish my degree. And after that, I joined ID Core in 2013, so this is my last year. Donald is in my same course. And I guess my project is a case study for like what can go wrong with ID Core, but still be solved and for the better. So I initially started to work on wind energy in Bristol with Lloyd's Register, but after, as soon as I started, there was a restructuring in the company, so the project was cancelled. I had to come back to Edinburgh. I started with Palamis Wave Power in 2014. And, well, you know how that ended up as well. And so at the end of 2014, start of 2015, my project was taken by Wave Energy Scotland. I really liked my time at Palamis. While I was at Palamis, I was part of the hydrodynamics team, so I was helping develop the numerical tools they had and compare them with the experimental tests that Chris did at Palamis. And I was also looking into optimizing the design for future wave energy converters. When I moved to Wave Energy Scotland, the project had to be changed because it had to take into account any type, it had to be applicable to any type of wave energy converter, so the geometry optimization was dropped. We just focused on control, and in particular on something that was realistic that can be applied in practice by wave developers. For some of you that may not know what wave energy converters are, these are some of the pictures. Whenever I say WEC, that stands for wave energy converter, and PTO basically means how you extract energy, and you can do it with hydraulic systems, electrical systems, or turbines in the case of an oscillating water column. And this is graphs like to show you how they actually the energy is extracted. And I've shown these two slides just to present to you the control problem of wave energy converters. The aim we have is to maximize the energy absorption, but at the same time, as you can see in this picture, like there can be big waves sometimes, like in this one. So you also need to apply some constraints to prevent failure when the waves are really large in extreme storms. And also, if possible, like reduce the size of the generators, because that can be really expensive. So reactive power flow should be limited if possible. So in control theory, just a very quick summary of control theory, like you got an input and you're trying to match it with a control system. But in order to do that, you actually get like, you need to have it to know the error signal. So this is like the feedback loop. And the aim at the end of the day is to match the output to the input. But at the same time, you will get disturbances along the way. And for the wave energy problem, these are, the input is what we know. So the device, we know the device motions, we know the generator power, the torque, the speed, we know the pressure in the accumulators, the power electronics, if you got an electronic power takeoff system. What we want to do is we want to get to control the power takeoff force. That's what we can do and control, and that's what we've done with accumulators or power electronics. And I think in the wave energy problem, what is really counterintuitive from a control perspective is that disturbance, this disturbance here, is actually what drives the control problem, because this is actually the wave energy, which has a big impact on the motion of the waves. And this can be measured with wave buoys or LIDAR system in America as well. And when I first started working on control system for wave energy, this was what I had in mind. But I soon realized that actually in the field of control system for wave energy converters, as Stephen would be, is definitely a better expert than me. But there is an alternative interpretation, which is a hydrodynamic interpretation of the system, which for me is actually simpler to understand. You have a dynamic system. This is in the frequency domain, so this is the wave energy, the wave frequency. And basically, you see that at the natural frequency, as expected, this is like a simple oscillator system, sort of. You get like a resonance at the natural frequency. And this is actually the absorb power. Now, if the aim is to maximize the energy, what you really want is this curve, which is the maximum extractable power. So you, what you want to do is like sort of change the dynamics response of the system so that you get resonance every single wave frequency or wave period. And this is done with these what we call control systems for wave energy devices. Like, this is called complex conjugate control. It cannot do in practice. This is resistive control. And this is latching control. And so the aim, as you can see, is to increase the area under this curve so that you get bigger wave energy absorption. This is actually all you want to do in the control problem for wave energy converters. There are different types of strategies that have been developed over the years, as you probably know, Stephen. And there are some of them are time average, so like resistive and reactive control. What you look at is like an average for the period of the waves, and you're trying to, you assume that the control force is proportional to a damping or a damping and a stiffness term, and you change the damping and the stiffness so that you can increase the curve. Like, this is complex conjugate where you have the stiffness as well, and this is only when you have the damping. As an alternative, you can work in the real time and have, you can like latch the device for part of the wave cycle and release it. Or you can also like declutch it, so it means like you just let it go for part of the wave cycle and then you control it again. And these strategies, these two and the two in the previous slide, are all based on this interpretation of the wave control problem as just trying to, like looking in the hydrodynamic domain, how to increase the capture width ratio of the device, like the natural frequency device, how to move it. Model predictive control is actually taken from control theory. It was developed in 2005, and it shows theoretically greater energy absorption, and this is because it's doing an optimization at every instant in time to every instant in time, what it does, it finds the force that results in maximum power absorption in the future for like a short time, and then it does it the next time step and so on. And this is, as you can see, this is based on a forecast. So the quality of the forecast will definitely affect the quality of the control and the energy absorption. So when I started my project, I did obviously literature review, found these control systems. I really liked them. I was really keen on model predictive control. But then Palamis Wave Power, they actually made a consideration from practical issues they had in their, during their application. And the problem is they observed that modeling errors were significant, and they had they actually decreased, like, if you predicted something with simulations, what you ended up having in the real world was really different. And so there was a loss in energy efficiency in waves, and that was biggest in extreme waves where the model tends to be most inaccurate as compared to reality. And at the same time, failure is most likely in these big waves, so that was a very major problem for Palamas wave power. And also at the same time, these control systems I mentioned, they're not adaptive. Like during the lifetime of Palamas, even though it was a very short lifetime for those devices, but you still had marine growth issues. And marine growth can actually change the dynamics of the system quite a lot. So the response of the system evolves throughout the year or throughout the 20-year lifetime. Life cycle of the device. So what Palamis asked was, is it possible to actually remove models of the device from the control systems of wave energy converters? They started looking into artificial intelligence, and then they stopped it for obvious reason. And this is the work I brought forward from Palamis to Wave Energy Scotland. So we looked into artificial intelligence because obviously it was the big thing that caused our attention. Like, there have been huge advances recently. And machine learning in particular, you get like machines that learn from direct interactions with the environment. That sounded really, really cool. So we decided to look into this a bit more and apply it to the wave control problem. In particular, because I had a 3-year project, which was actually 2.5, I focus on 2 things. One is reinforcement learning. The other one is neural networks. And I think most of you will be familiar with neural networks, but may not have heard of the first one. Now, reinforcement learning is a framework to make decisions. It's a very mathematical framework, and you get like the controller that has to make decision. It was applied like to helicopter flight, model a helicopter flight. This is from Stanford, or from South Korea in the DARPA Challenger Robotics Challenge. Neural networks are a very powerful tool. They're a very powerful nonlinear model. They're used in the Google car, for instance. But I don't particularly like them because they're sort of a black box, whereas this is quite easy to understand. But, I mean, you can cross-check if there are problems with the model, whereas in this case, it's much harder. But this is can be like a more powerful tool in the future. So to start with, as I mentioned, I had a brief background on me. I described briefly the wave control problem and why we decided to go with this artificial intelligence. Now, the rest of the presentation will be mainly on like a short introduction of a case study about reinforcement learning, so that I hope to get you interested enough that you might use it in your research as well. And I will have a short case study on my research as well, but just a very brief one. And then I will describe in detail how you actually can apply this in your research as well. So with reinforcement learning, using the jargon of reinforcement learning, you have an agent. And in this case, as a broad example for everyone, I decided to go for Pac-Man because most people are familiar with that. So in this case, we want to teach Pac-Man how to play the game by itself. And the environment it has in this case is a Pac-Man grid with ghosts and pellets and power pellets. And the idea is that Pac-Man, at every step of the algorithm, is in a state, which is a position in the grid, at the distance from every pellet and at the distance from the ghost. And then it has to decide in each step of the algorithm to take an action. And say it goes right, it will land in a new state, the green state, the blue state. And it will have moved position, so it will have changed state, and it will be a new distance from the ghost as well. And as it does this, it will get a reward if it meets a pellet, or it will get a penalty if it actually is caught by a ghost. And the reason for this reward or penalty is fundamental, is because the machine does not actually know what it's supposed to do. So the only way to actually learn it is if you sort of give it rewards or penalties so that it can understand what's actually the best case scenario. And this behavior of the machine is actually what's called policy in this framework. So as you've seen with this test case, well, with this Pac-Man thing, you have discrete states and discrete actions, but don't be afraid, there is actually function approximation, and I've used it. And that's fundamental because otherwise it's not really applicable to a control problem. So you can use linear, polynomials, neural networks, radio basis functions. And the memory is also really important of the problem, because the machine, if it does not remember what it did in the past, there's no way it's going to actually understand what it should do in the future, learn what it should do in the future. And so this is called the Q function, which is basically a measure of the rewards. And this is shown by this very simple equation for a very simple algorithm of reinforcement learning called Q learning. At each step of the algorithm, you update the Q value for each state, for the particular state and action you were in, by this product of the learning rate, which determines how much old information you keep and how much new information you actually store in the system, which is a function of the reward, a discount factor, because you also discount for things in the future. And this term is really important because this is the maximum Q value of the state you're landing into. So this is a sort of looking into the future. By taking an action in a specific state, you want to know what the reward will be, not in the immediate step you're taking, but also what the reward will be in the future. Like, by taking that action, you want to know which state you land into and whether there will be a reward or a penalty. And so you're looking in the future, and that is really important to actually learn a correct policy. Now, another quite important thing to remember in this, to consider in this reinforcement learning, is the issue of exploitation versus exploration. Now, let's say that we've already started the Pac-Man game, and Pac-Man knows that in the specific location it is in, if he goes left or down, it will get a pellet. If he goes right, it will get into a ghost. So if it is exploitative, he selects the best action, which is either of these two. But it can also decide to be explorative and explore the up situation. It might actually find a power pellet, which actually gives it a much bigger reward. So sometimes it's quite good to actually like explore new things in this case, in these situations. Another example is if you want to design a wave energy converter and all you know is paint or AutoCAD 2D, it's obviously you will go for AutoCAD 2D. But you might actually explore AutoCAD Inventor, which might be actually a better choice overall. And as a rule of thumb, you should start a simulation with a lot of exploration, because at the start you don't know what you're looking at, like the machine does not know what it's supposed to do. But then as you do some learning, it's really important to shift the focus to exploitation, otherwise it will keep on doing random stuff when you don't want it to do random stuff. This is actually one of the dangerous things of these machine learning control systems. As a case study of a more practical design, I consider the resistive control of a wave energy converter. And this is because considering only one device, just no array, just one single device. So this is a very simple case to understand. It's already implemented. Resistive control has real applications. Pilavis used it. Carnegie Wave Power uses it. Seabase uses it. And it does show improvement over a more simple control system. So what you have is the control force is now a damping term, is proportional to damping, and you're trying to optimize the damping coefficient for each wave period, or significant wave height if you actually have excessive motions. So in this case, the agent is the controller, the environment is the machine, like the wave energy converter in waves. The power takeoff system will be the state, like you discretize it, if we ignore function approximation to start with. The action will be a change in the damping coefficient. The reward is a function of the generated power, because that's actually what you want to maximize. You want to maximize the generated power, which should be average, or the energy. But this does not tell you the whole story, because as we said, you need to consider the significant wave height and energy wave period as well. And the way to do it is to use an external wave buoy that returns this information to the system. And it's really clear that in order for reinforcement learning to work in wave energy, it's fundamental that you look at a time average problem, because waves are oscillatory in nature. So if you give a reward when you're in a trough, it's going to be negative. That's not good. And at the same time, so like random waves, irregular waves, are really stochastic. So you need to look at a long, well, relatively long, say a couple of minutes wave trace at least, to return a sort of a, and look at the average condition over those 2 minutes. Otherwise, reinforcement learning may never learn because you may just get something random in that 2 minutes, in a very shorter period of time, like 20 seconds, that might just make it impossible to learn something. So the time average approach is actually what is most difficult. Before our research, it was never applied to wave energy converters because this is actually something that was not taken into account. And this is fundamental if you want to apply to wave energy converters. This case study was tested and validated with simulations because I didn't have funding for experiments, and also with simulations you know exactly what the optimal should be. And you look, if we look at regular waves, the optimum is always like the simulation optimum is always the dotted line. Reinforcement learning is the continuous line. You see that it does learn the optimal damping coefficient and the corresponding generated power quite well in regular waves. This is as expected because they're deterministic. But it does so also in irregular waves, where actually even the average power is really wobbly. So that was a really difficult test case for reinforcement learning. Now, one of the things that really worried me about this is it takes 8 hours to converge. This is a very, very long time. So we did show that there is convergence in regular and irregular waves, but this 10-hour learning time is really worrying. So, and especially if you consider that, like, the finer you make the discretization, the longer the time might be. But at the same time, there's actually, if you want to apply this in practice, the change in the damping coefficient will occur either as a change in resistance or as a change in the pressure in the system, and those are actually discrete in practice because that's the way the power takeoff system work. The time is actually short as compared to the lifetime of the device, but a C state lasts up to a maximum of six hours. So we had to run different tests in multiple C waves, multiple C states, and we actually saw that the controller was able, if it was in a C state, and stopped the optimization before it reached the optimum. After it went to a different C state and came back into that C state, it was able to remember what it did before, and it just picks it up again. But still, I wasn't really satisfied with that, so we tried different algorithms and functional approximation, and we cut the time by 40%. So my advice is, if you're going to reinforcement learning, do use the most advanced algorithms from the start, because otherwise it just takes too long. And additional considerations, modeling errors are no longer a problem with reinforcement learning, nor with neural networks. And the controller, in theory, can adapt to changes in the machine with time if you just restart the exploration, like, say, a year into the lifetime, 2 years into the lifetime of the device. We also applied it to reactive control, to more complex devices like nonlinear models and two-body devices. We haven't applied it yet to arrays or wave energy converters, and this is I will get back to this later on, but I think this is something that someone else might do in the future. And some comments on these algorithms, since I tried quite a lot of them. I don't think reinforcement learning is the best for resistive and reactive control. I think neural networks are much better because they're continuous, and so for resistive and reactive control that are continuous, like you're trying to find an optimum, I think neural networks coupled with an optimization tool are much better, and this is also what we've shown. On the other hand, reinforcement learning is really good if you've got an application with a bang-bang type of control. Like, if you have a limited set of actions, reinforcement learning is definitely the tool you should go for, because it's this decision-making tool, which is really good. Like, if you go a bang-bang type of control, or, like, say, choose three actions, like opening or closing a valve, this is definitely the way to go. And this is why we've been applying it to declutching and latching control with Gordon from last week as well. Now, finally, I guess this is what might interest you overall. How can this actually help you? So reinforcement learning and neural networks have been applied to the control of a wind turbine by Americans in Nebraska. They also did experimental testing. The neural networks have been applied to the control of smart grids and small-scale grids. And so if you want to do some applications, if you want to look into these algorithms for these applications, my advice is to look into different types of reinforcement learning schemes or neural network schemes, such as the LSBI I mentioned, or look into the coupling with different types of control systems, like maximum point tracking devices. But I think what's most important, what is most interesting, is to apply them to maybe array of wave energy converters, even though this will actually be covered by Wes in the next call, I think. Arrays of wind turbines, this is actually really interesting for, I think, for the industry at the moment, because the wind industry is quite big, so I think this is a very good application for these types of controls, artificial intelligent methods. A tidal turbine, I think someone here is already doing that, and arrays of tidal turbines is really interesting as well. And if you want to go for more fancy methods, you can look into support vector machines, which are relatively similar to neural networks. And gradient boosting is by far the best I've tried for other applications, but it's probably too advanced for control systems at the moment. So just a heads up on the comparison between wind and tidal energy and wave energy. As I mentioned, in wave energy, you need to look into time average things. With wind energy in particular, that's not a problem, so it means it converges so much faster that you can actually experimentally test it. So the control of a wind farm with reinforcement learning, neural networks, or support vector machines is totally feasible, and even like on experimental base. And you can also use simplifying relationships, which make everything easier. I thought this applied to tidal turbines as well, but Anupas actually told me that with turbulence and waves, that is not the case. You still need the time average approach. And so if you need help with any of these, if you're like interested in these tools, I know this has been a lot into a very short time. So if you're interested into like starting research with these topics, even in smart grids, just come to me. I can help you out. I'm here until July next year. And if you've got any questions, I'm ready to answer them.
This production is brought to you by the University of Edinburgh.